I've been thinking lately, what about the kids who are 8 years old, 9 years old, very formative time in their lives, 7 years old, and they're now being told that there's this virus, and they're going to give it to their grandparents, and they're going to kill their parents, and they better be careful. And what kind of, what are the implications for future generations based on these two current events, that are things that are going on now?
Well, research shows right now that children are more at risk for increased anxiety and depression in their lives, because what's happened right now is children are more compromised. We are, with this hardship on families, there's even families being displaced, there's the closing of schools and the risk of human trafficking. So children are more scared, more vulnerable, families are more stressed, so there are more cases of abuse. What happens is, With trauma, with anything that's scary, especially a pandemic, there's three types of stress, and we need to understand this as a community. There's positive stress, which is, you know, we are in the spelling bee. Yeah, good stress, right?
Yeah,
and that helps us have someone with us who's guiding us, comforting us. We're good. Then we have tolerable stress. Okay, tolerable stress is where our dog may have been hit by a car and now they're in the hospital, but we have family around us who are helping buffer and support us through this tolerable experience, and we come back to a baseline and we're okay.
Got it. It's even eustress. Couldn't it even be tolerable stress can turn into eustress or good stress if it's done correctly? No.
Yeah. Right, exactly. That's resiliency. That's where we find resiliency. We go through adverse experiences like we are as a world, as a community, going through this pandemic. We will get through this. We will eventually, there will be an end. It may take time, but we're tolerating this. We're tolerating not going to school, not going to jobs, being on Zoom every day. So that's tolerable stress. Then we have toxic stress. And this is prolonged activation of the stress system, which is that high cortisol being flooded in the brain, in the body, and that person is on a high alert, always seeking what is danger, what is a threat to me. They're not able to intercept that stress system by saying, okay, hold on, is this a false alarm, or am I truly in danger right now? And that's where we're getting stuck. It's between tolerable and toxic stress.
Yeah.
Because toxic stress, if you're alone, if you're isolated, and you don't have somebody helping you, and you don't have the self, you don't have the tools, you don't have the mental health guidance and understanding of how to intercept your stress system by deep breathing, understanding there's a polyvagal nerve that if you just intercept it, slow down the nervous system, you can come back to a baseline. But if you're in a daily stress mode and you're flooded with cortisol, that can become this toxic stress that you become familiar with, and that becomes your homeostasis.
Yeah, that's right. You get addicted to it. You can get habituated to it.
Yeah.
So that kind of feeling.
You reenact that stress in relationship. You're constantly seeking out, what is a threat? Oh, good, because this is my homeostasis. You're seeking out relationships.
Yeah, that's your homeostasis.
Exactly.
That's awesome. Yeah, I totally understand what you're saying now. I always thought powerlessness plays a role here, a sense that you don't have any control. What do you think about that?
So with people who've experienced trauma, what happens is there's a learned helplessness that develops. Why?
Right.
Because they've endured this toxic stress. They've had this repeated stimuli of either abuse, neglect, witnessing domestic violence, or being hurt themselves physically or sexually. And this repeated stimuli becomes this internal belief system. It's beyond their control. I don't know what to do. I can't get out of it because there's stuck in that activation, that prolonged stress on a daily basis that can be lasting for years.
Oh, yeah. You know, here's the thing. Check this out, Doc.
Yeah.
We raise children to feel powerless. Our systems and our institutions are almost designed intentionally. I don't know if they are, but they're almost. I mean, the case could be made that it's intentional to make our kids feel powerless. So we create a culture and a society where people feel powerless, and via this habituation mechanism that you're talking about, and even all our institutions. Look at all the powerlessness that's going on in the world today.
Yes. I mean, listen, we want people to learn how to navigate the world. We want them to learn how to be interdependent, not codependent, not fully dependent on the government, on their communities, that they can be their own self and learn how to function in the world. What happens is when we have children who go from home to home to home, and there's no one person that's mm-hmm. of resilience for them, that's watching
yeah.
them,
yeah.
guiding them, that's there to meet their needs when they
that's
have
gotta
help.
That's got to be terrifying. That's got to be terrifying.
It is terrifying. And I work with a lot of these kids who either run away from the foster care system, who are living on the streets because their own families aren't recognizing.
Yeah, that's
and
unbelievable.
Listen, we're dealing with also communities that don't have the resources available
uh-huh.
for mental health.
Well, they better have the resources because yeah. they're going to be spending them somewhere else, you know, later on down the road. All right, we got Dr. Jeanette-ically from the Celia Center. Dr. Jeanette Yaffe is a marriage and family therapist. We're talking childhood trauma and good health. We'll be back with more of Dr. Yaffe on the Bright Side right after this.